Sarita, I think you're on mute, ma'am.
Yeah, she's on
yeah,
mute.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Puneet. Thank you, Smera and Rahul, for facilitating this. I'm really excited for today's session. And it's a good thing that we are sharing knowledge through whatever way it's available right now, be it online, webinars, or sessions. So before getting started, all I want to tell you is that when I started with API documentation 2 years ago, I was a bit startled seeing a Postman screen in one Postman and Swagger editor. It may look a little confusing, but at the end of it, you know, you just need a little bit of practice to master it. So today's session is basically catered to show you that this may look overly complicated, but they are actually very, very simple concepts to learn. You don't need any prior technical knowledge or programming skills to come up with good documentation. And documentation, again, you will have different companies would have different challenges at what level of granularity you need to document the information. So we will cover various aspects. In one next 1 hour, we'll cover various aspects of the documentation. But I would like to give you a brief history about the API, how it evolved and what is the future and how technical writers can contribute for the first half hour. And then we'll move on to documentation. So let's get started now. So I'll share my screen. So is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, Sarita.
Yes.
Sure.
Okay. So today's agenda, we are going to cover a little bit history of evolution of APIs and the different styles of API. There are more than 3-4 different styles of API. We will cover the most popular one, which is the REST API. We will also touch upon the second most popular, which is SOAP. But predominantly, we are going to cover the documentation based on REST APIs. We will also cover how HTTP request is different from the API request. Apart from that, I would like to share certain use cases on how APIs are used in our day-to-day lives. So of course, our main area of interest here is to know what is the role of technical writer, how we can contribute towards the API economy, and the different approaches that we can use, the standards, the tools, and due to time constraint, I will be covering only the most popular tools and most popular requirements. Also, we will cover a bit of a dev workflow, development workflow. It will help us understand who our stakeholders are and to what level we need to go about with the documentation. So that's the agenda for today's meeting. So a quick refresher on how APIs evolved. You can see that maybe we would have heard about mainframe computers. They were really large computers, and it came about in 1970s. Then came about network of mainframe computers. This was around 1980s. Then in 1980s, again, personal computers became a boom, and that led to local area networks and wide area networks. In 1990s, when internet became popular, and when it started powering the mobile, then we know that there is no looking back ever since, because we got so connected, and then there is not a single day we can be without our smartphones, because we want to be always connected. So from our screens, we can travel across the world and in time. When the internet was maturing, our need for transferring information from machine to machine became much more important. So that's gave birth to web services. So web services are always based on APIs, but all APIs need not be web services. These are the things that we need to keep in mind. So when mobile internet came about, we also have Internet of Things like Alexa, smartwatches. So these technologies need a very powerful but yet very easy to implement communication system, and that's where REST APIs got prominence. And the new kid on the block in API documentation world is the GraphQL. So we will touch upon these different architectural styles in the coming slides. So this is what I wanted to cover as a quick refresher from standalone mainframe print systems to we are here with Internet of Things and web services. Pretty much a lot of products and services are only based on internet and APIs. So you might be wondering what is an API and how is it different from a regular browser request. So when you type HTTP google.com, is that an API? No, it is not an API because the architecture or the approach is different. To give you an idea, when you browse something and the data you get is a combination of an HTML file, CSS, and JavaScript. So that's what you see. It is the intent behind is human readability. So this is meant for human beings to decipher data. So this is the fundamentals behind the browser request, whereas the API request are meant for basically for machine-to-machine interaction. So supposing you are in a coffee shop and you want to order a cup of coffee, but you are in a foreign country and you don't know the language. So obviously you will be a little bit stuck, but you will not be stuck if you have a trusted friend who can translate the language and help you get the coffee. So that's what the API does. It connects to different systems that speak to different languages. For one system could be probably programmed in .NET and another system could be programmed in JavaScript. But API uses a standard format of JSON or XML to translate the request and response, and that's how machines communicate with each other. So the intent for web browser is human interaction, and between API is for machine interaction. So as we discussed about the different styles in the previous slide, now we'll touch upon the popular API styles. They are SOAP-based APIs and RESTful APIs. SOAP is nothing but simple object access protocol. So it is more of a protocol than a protocol based on certain predefined rules. So SOAP functions based on certain predefined structure. That structure has to be followed. Only then the request and response would work. Whereas representational state transfer, which is the REST API, is more agile and lightweight and more easy to implement. So we'll see certain key differentiators between the two. As I mentioned, it's a SOAP is more of a protocol, whereas REST is a more of an architectural style. It has a certain definite guidelines, but they don't have a very rigid rules and recommendations. So that's why documentation has much more relevance. The reason is there is no, you can implement REST APIs in a slightly different way. So there could be same APIs implemented in a different way. That's why documentation has a lot of relevance, which we'll again cover, come up in the future slides on what are the challenges faced in REST documentation. When it comes to security, SOAP has security built into it, whereas REST has security element imposed on it it's an add-on. Security is an add-on. Both are secure for sure, but SOAP APIs can be said as doubly secure. But REST is, I wouldn't say the REST is not secure or less secure, but security is inbuilt in the SOAP APIs. When it comes to performance, you can associate SOAP with a heavyweight system. It requires a lot more bandwidth and it requires more computing power, whereas REST is nimble and requires very few resources. When it comes to data format, SOAP accepts only XML. It transmits and gets response only in the XML, whereas REST supports plain text, HTML, XML, JSON, YAML, and other formats. When it comes to transferring protocol, SOAP has more options. SOAP supports HTTP, SMTP, etc., whereas REST API supports only HTTP. So just to give you a difference between, as I mentioned, SOAP supports XML and REST supports JSON. So from this screen, you will get an idea that just to convey the name, first name and last name of your siblings, JSON, XML takes more number of lines than the JSON file would take. So you can see from this example that XML files are usually large and bulky, because it has certain tags and attributes to be associated in HTM. Plus, there are certain add-ons because obviously XML files becomes large. This is the reason why JSON is preferred over XML. So just to give you a bit of information about the different API styles, we are mostly going to cover only REST, but there are GraphQL, which I said is a new kid on the block. GraphQL and REST API based on similar architectural style, but in REST API, if you have to send 3 requests to complete a response, in GraphQL, you can do that in one request itself. So GraphQL is gaining popularity because of that. And RESTQL has seen phenomenal growth in the last 10 years. Almost 80% of the public APIs that are available right now are based on REST. So as you see, the green line is based on the decline of the usage of SOAP, but it is still used in large enterprises and where data has to be very, very secure, such as in banking transactions and in similar where financial transactions are involved. So you might be wondering that whether APIs are that popular. So I just want to give you an example. If you are using Ola or Uber, or you have checked weather forecast or booked tickets online, or you've checked stock prices online, I can say that you have already consumed services that are powered by APIs. But since these experiences are so seamless, you may not realize that there was an API functioning behind collecting these data. So we'll take an example of Uber. You can say that the Uber infrastructure is solely based on Amazon Web Services. They wanted uninterrupted services, so they have partnered with Amazon Web Services for their infrastructure. For their communication, be it messages or email, they depend on the Twilio. For their navigation, they depend on Google Maps. For their payments, they depend on Braintree. It's a subsidiary of PayPal. And again, Twilio for their emails. So I would say that what is Uber gaining from this? To be in short, the beauty of this model is that Uber owns the user experience and the business model. For everything else, they rely on third-party specialized service providers. This is possible only because these service providers are exposing their services as APIs. So if there are players in that industry, for example, for communication, Twilio is the market leader, then they have much more possibility of being integrated into several other applications. That's why it is much more relevant in these times that they expose their API, and other services can make use of them, partner with them, and run their businesses. So it's much more easier. You don't have to invest on building from scratch. You can just partner with a specialist and start your business, and it makes creating new products much more easier. So now coming to another example based on API. So if you go to the site called Go Hire, this is mainly for recruiters to post online job postings. So what it does is you post job opening once and it is pushed to multiple portals in just one go. So, but imagine if there was no API powering this, the recruiter would have to go into each and every career portal and post their job recruitment. So that is a manual process. So this service has made life of recruiters far easier, that they can post their request only once and it is covered in almost all popular job portals. So from these examples, you might be wondering if APIs are only for external services or, you know, when you want to integrate some external services. But that is not the case. We will cover how APIs can be used internally as well. I hope you would have come across the term monolith platform or monolith applications. Basically, if you have not come across these terms, these are applications that are being built as an autonomous unit. So this monolithic architecture includes user interface, business logic, data transfer, and the database are tightly coupled. So it makes it a little difficult to scale such systems. If you want to modify a small section of the code, you might have to build and deploy an entirely new version of the software. So like I said, scaling was also a challenge. So microservices came into picture to solve this problem, where microservices breaks down the different aspects of a monolithic into multiple small containerized units, so that these units can be scaled independently. For example, if you take an e-commerce site, there could be a separate unit for orders, there could be a separate unit for customers, there could be a separate unit for tracking other product inventory managers. So these need not be tightly coupled. They are loosely coupled and they communicate with each other through API. So we saw example of how APIs can be used externally, or external APIs can be integrated into your system. Plus we also saw now how APIs are used internally as well. So when it comes to documentation, my request is that you must consider internal APIs and external APIs as equals, because that's when you can add value as technical writers, and that's when adoption also becomes faster. So as technical writers, you might be keen to know that how you can participate and how you can contribute to the API economy. So if you see this particular survey, it was conducted by Tom Johnson and published in his blog site, I'd Rather Be Writing. So his blog site is a very popular site for API documentation course, as well as other technical writing related content. So according to his survey, you can see that accurate and detailed documentation is in the top three consideration. This is because REST API is an architectural style, and the style can vary from one system to another system. So when the developers are not sure on how it is implemented, they need some kind of documentation to rely on. But documentation, just write about documentation. When you write for developers, the expectation is that they have basic understanding, but they need to know the nuances or especially about when it comes to API, they would like to know how it is implemented and how they can integrate it with their system. So that's the kind of information that should be accurately represented. So for API documentation, our users are the developers mostly. So you follow the same approach. How you would write for a user guide, the same approach. You have to create and maintain a style guide. If you are new to API documentation, you can refer to some style guides available online. You can see what are the best practices. You can see how others are implemented it, some of which we will cover in today's demo, but I'm just walking you through that. So design style guides are available by Google, Microsoft, Cisco, PayPal, and they have all contributed to a common style guide called Open API Specification. This Open API Specification is used not only to build and develop APIs, but also to write API documentation. So this is a good reference point to get started with. So you can see that in 2016 and 2019, the survey pretty much said the same thing. It has given topmost importance to accurate and detailed documentation, because many times it leads to a frustrated developer who doesn't know how to run the API and the API fails. So you got a little bit of understanding about APIs. So now you will see how to go about it. So we will also cover JSON format. JSON is nothing but it's a structured approach for JavaScript, which is what is used in APIs commonly. We'll also see an overview of Postman. The detailed Postman is not in the purview of today's session, but we will definitely see what we can do with Postman. We'll try out an API. We'll understand its structure and what standards they are following. We'll see some popular tools, and then we will go on to demo. So if I straight away go to the demo, you might miss certain parts. So because of that, I want to cover certain aspects of the JSON file and an overview of Postman. So this is a sample JSON format. The one in the curl, in the double quotes, you can see is a key value pair. So you can see a key and you can see a value. Here down below, you can see a key and you can see a value. This is a sample JSON file I created for the purpose of today's session. So you see that this particular key has a value and this value is of the type string. So you call this data types. So JSON has very few data types that is very easy to remember and recollect. So anything in text is put it in double quotes. So it is this is a text value, that is why it's a string. This particular value is number 10. It is a number, that's why it doesn't have a double quote. So whenever there is a double quote, you will know that it is a string. The next key is recording and its value is true, which is a Boolean. So Boolean takes just two values, true or false. True means this recording is true. And null means there is no information. So you can see we covered in the JSON. You see that JSON will always start with a curly bracket and end with a curly bracket. The key value pair, key will always be in quotes and the value will be in quotes only if it's string, otherwise it will not be in quotes. The next we will see that the next value has an array because array will always come with a square bracket. This is a square bracket. Within that, there are multiple values. So array has multiple values. So it's called array supports multiple values. Array can also support objects. So we can see that next key is organizers. It is an object. It is an array. Within that array, we can see objects. Here the object is name and email. And the same thing is repeated. So that means this organizers could be more than one person. So that is why this is an array and this array has multiple objects. So you can see that in presenter, there is many more open curly brackets and closed curly brackets. So that means these are all objects. So this presenter starts with an object. That this object contains the name and profession of the presenter, and the contact details again has a nested object called address. Address has another nested object called within that address there are street, landmark, state, and city, followed by phone. Phone has primary phones and the mobile phone. So you can see. So you can see to understand JSON, it may look a bit confusing in the first if you're seeing it for the first time, but it is nothing but key value pair. It will always start with a curly bracket and end with a curly bracket. It will be key value pair. The value could be a string, it could be a number, it could be a Boolean, it could be a null value, it could be an array, or it could be an object. It could be an array of objects, or it could be object within objects. So if you just get an opportunity to see more than one or two JSON objects, either through Google or some opportunity, if you get, you will be able to relate to it much better. So I would like to also share a bit of information about Postman. Postman is basically a testing tool, but it is also used as a complete API development tool as well. In certain firms use it as a complete API development. So they design APIs in Postman, document in Postman, they run certain scripts and they make an automated testing feature on it. They can monitor and they can publish their API. So everything can be done. The entire API lifecycle can be staged through Postman as well. So this screen could be a bit confusing for you. So I will just show you a dummy Postman request. Can you guys see my screen right now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sure. So, just a minute. So this is the famous weather API that many sites you will get whenever you want to see some dummy APIs to run. This is a very close, neatly available APIs. You don't have much, you just have to run it. This is a GET request. I took this from Tom Jones's technical writing blog site. This is a weather API. If you have, you can give the longitude and latitude and longitude of your location, and you will get an API key. This is called as API ID here. If you get this key, you will get the response. So I will run this from the start. So you can see that there is a base path. Then these are called query parameters after the question mark. If you can see a question mark, the one comes after that are called query parameters. In the query parameters, you can see the same information already transmitted into the query parameters. Latitude, the value we gave here is all reflecting here automatically. Latitude, longitude, whether to exclude hourly or daily, and the app ID. This ID, I got it from the site. You have to log into the site to get this. So this is how this API can be run. There is no other authorization available, or no headers particularly required, or no body parameters added here. You just have to run this API and you will get the weather details of the location Chicago. So this API link is already available in I Would Rather Be Writing site. If you're interested, you can go and run it by yourself. You just have to install Postman in your system. So moving on to the present, so I just wanted to show you how API looks like. So how API and how API can be used for testing. As technical writers, we don't have to really test each and every API in order to document. But the challenge is, without knowing the how API functions, what kind of requests are required in order to get our required response, it might be a little challenging for us. So I encourage all of you to at least install Postman and run a couple of APIs by yourself. Then you will know what are the challenges that a developer would face when they try to run a third-party APIs. So that is why even though Postman is not in the purview of today's session, I'm just covering a gist of it. So I encourage you to run a few test APIs to get a better understanding of how Postman works. So we will take another example of how to run an API. So this time we will take, right now we took a weather API as an example. Now we will take take an e-commerce site. How you would have all added items to cart. So I took a workflow that can be easily related, something to be added onto your cart. So hold on, I'm just trying to pull up the screen. So this is just a dummy site. It's called demo store. It's not a real store. This is just a dummy site to show for the demo purpose. So you can see that in the cart, there are three items already. I removed them. And then add an item to cart from the UI, you see that one item is added. You can do the same thing from the Postman as well. So you can see that I have posted the link here, and I have added for this particular site to run, you need an authorization key. I have the authorization key can be taken from the site itself, from the API providers, and you enter the API key and you have added the API key, and you try to, and here this particular request, since you're adding a product, you need to give what product, what ID, what is the ID of the product, what is the quantity you want, and what is its variant. A product can have multiple variants. If you order a shoe, like Nike shoe, you can have Nike Air, you can have Nike Max. So these are the variants that you're mentioning here. So this is a very simple request that you can send, and this is the response you will get for the API. So this is an example to show that you can add an item to either from UI or through API. It will have the same results. So in the Postman, we saw this. We saw that we can do method, which is the one we did was the one we did for the weather app was a get, and the one we did for the e-commerce was the post. So there are other methods also. Get is to retrieve information, post it to create information. So you want to add something, it is like creating an item into your cart. It falls under post category. Then you have a put request. Put is nothing but to update, as well as you can delete. You can delete items from in this example that I just showed. You can retrieve your items in the cart. You can post, you can add items into the cart. You can update the items in your cart. You can delete them, or you can delete one item in the cart, or you can delete the whole cart. And patch is nothing but a partial edit. So put is a complete overhaul, and patch is a partial edit. So you will see in Postman supports some other formats as well, but these are the popular requests that you can send. This is a Postman screen. And this one, the one this shown is a base path. So when you start documenting APIs, you have to declare base path once. You don't have to, in a particular file, you don't have to repeat base path time and again. It's just the best practice. There are no hard and fast rules over there. Then you have the cart ID that you will give. In the example that we saw there was an authorization required which was updated in the header section, and you want to specify what item you want to mention in the cart. So that item cannot be specified in one line, so that is why the body comes into picture. So when the request is long, in the weather API that we saw, there was nothing to mention in the body of the request. But here you have to mention the quantity, you have to mention the product ID, then you have to mention what variant product we are talking about in specific. So that is why you need to define an object. So that is done through the body. And you have to make sure that the file that you're running is a JSON file. And this is the request. You can see the request here. You submitted ID, quantity, variant, and that's how you send the request body in the JSON format. This is a JSON format because it starts with an opening bracket, a curly bracket, and ends with a curly bracket. In between, you have key value pair. And within that, you have another sub object. In the response, you will get for a REST API, you will always get a JSON object as a response. So you can also see what it returned. When you run an API and if it is successful, you will get 200 OK. 200 OK always means that your API run was successful and the result you got is based on the request you have sent. If you get anything other than 200 OK, that means that the API was not successful. It will also give you a hint about what went wrong. So if I run it again, if I run the same Postman again, I will get an error. This time I didn't get an error, but sometimes you would get an error as well in this place, and it will be, supposing I change the syntax, I forgot a comma here, because all this should end in comma except the last one. So I missed the comma, it will show me an error. You can say 422 unprocessable entity. So that's because it missed a syntax. It's not always very straightforward error response. Your error response wouldn't say that you missed a syntax. But you need to be watchful of whether what kind of syntaxes are required, what have been missed. If you put quantity zero, let's see what happens. If you put quantity zero, still it is returning something. Ideally, I'm not sure how this API is designed, but it is just returning that the value. It is simply returning that there is a something is added. Maybe zero is not considered as an inappropriate quantity, I guess. So this is how API is run. If there is any error, you will also get the status code here other than 200 OK. So So now coming back to the presentation. So there are different documentation approaches that you can use, and different tools are there. But in this today's session, we will cover only the popular ones, which is called Open API Specification based on Swagger. Swagger is the most popular tool. Then there are documentation possible through Postman also, but it is not that intuitive as it is in Swagger editor. Postman editing tools is limited and it supports Markdown. But if you're creating an entirely new API in Postman and you have a documentation available in YAML, it supports adding a documentation there. Then there is Redoc, which I'm not familiar with, but since it's a popular tool, I have mentioned it, but I have not used it, so I cannot comment on how easy or difficult it is. I have used Postman and I have used Swagger. So I can say that Swagger is far more intuitive and much more easy to rework on that. So I can say that, hello?
We can hear you.
Okay, so. So there are other approaches as well, RAML and API Blueprint. Again, I must be honest that I have not worked on RAML or API Blueprint, but they are different approaches. But we are only going to cover the most popular ones. So I have stuck to, REST API documentation using Swagger. So now let's get started with an API documentation using Swagger Editor. A few things you need to consider as we discussed is just like a user manual, you need to have an understanding of who the audience are, what is their requirement, and we need to have a style guide to go with a company's, to have the messaging that a company wants to share. And whenever you're documenting a new API, an API that is being created right now and it's not in production, or an existing API that's already in production and being used by different clients, you need to have a description for the resource and the endpoint and the various parameters. It could be a header parameter, it could be a query parameter, it could be a path parameter or a request body. And we need to make sure that we mention for each and every attribute, what is the description, what are its data type, because developers might struggle to know, supposing there is an attribute called date. They may not, there may be attribute called telephone number. They may not know if it is always number, because if there is a hyphen in between, you cannot just give the data type as number. You have to give it as a string. So depending on what format is being used, we will have to understand what is the data type and add an example to depict its format. And you need to also place resources in a way that the easier resources or more easy to consume or first resources come in the top, and the complex ones come towards the bottom of the documentation. And certain recommendations for documentation is that the naming should be, naming of the resources should be plural, and it should be intuitive. If there is any changes into the API that is already in production, such as there is a new version available or an existing API is going to be deprecated, it must be documented as well. And it should make a backward compatibility for any changes. Backward compatibility in the sense when there is a change implemented, it doesn't break an existing client's API request. So this is just an API development process. When you get a request, they analyze the request, then they design and they code and they test and they deliver. So it comes, that is the general pattern. But when it comes to API, the best practice is they design first. Previously, the approach was to code first, and now the approach has changed to design first. Design first gives them a ready-made feedback. Once they design an API, they can share it with the stakeholders, get feedback, and then start coding instead of coding and then making a whole lot of changes into the code. So that's just a best practice that many companies follow. So API is basically owned by the technical team and business team. So business team knows the business logic behind an API, and the technical developers develop the API keeping the technology in mind. So these are basically the information on who are the stakeholders of an API. So now we'll start with the documentation. So as I mentioned, we are covering the documentation part right now, and we'll start from a clean slate. I will delete what is available here, and this is a Swagger editor tool. In the left hand side you can see where the YAML files can be edited, and in the right hand side you can see the whatever is documented here, you can easily read it in from the pane in the right side. This is mainly for rendering, and whenever you make any edits or anything, you can see whether it is coming correctly, whether this is an object, whether it's a request body. So all those information can come here handy. So I am just for this sake of training, I will not be covering in detail, but I would be covering a post, get, put, and delete, how to document these two these four methods, and how to structure your information. So we'll start with a clean slate. We'll delete this information here on the left side. So whenever you are using, so as I mentioned, I'm using OpenAPI 3.0 specification. So you need to mention which version you are using here. That is OpenAPI specification. You can ignore the errors as of now. As and when it is incomplete, it will keep showing errors. So that is also one way to fix your documentation. Whenever the documentation is complete and you still see some errors, that means you need to do some additional fixing. Then comes the info. Then comes the info part. In info, you have version, title, description, and contact. So that version of this particular document is, this is a metadata. So the version is one. This has to follow this pattern 1.0.0. You can give an intuitive title here. The title I gave is API interface for XYZ e-commerce business layer. You can give the firm name here. Along with title, it is good to give a description for this API, which is e-commerce API to build storefront. So many of the e-commerce API providers, they just like I mentioned, Uber owns the user experience. When they interact and they take services from third party, the user experience is still owned by them. Likewise, when storefronts are built using e-commerce API, the UI part is what they focus on, because they want to give a different user experience. They don't want a common screen to be used throughout. So they only consume API, but the storefront, the UI part is built by their front-end developers. So that's the primary purpose of e-commerce APIs. So you will always give a contact details on whom to contact when there is a problem with the API. And the URL. And the email address on who to contact. These are all dummy information. These are not real information. And we will cover the license, because this is a best practice. You will get this information from the developers on what is the license number and license details. Here the license name is Apache 2.0, and this is the URL. You will also give server details. So in the info, you can see that version, title, description, contact, licenses are all metadata, and it is under the tag info. But server is not part of the info. It is a separate data. You need to give the URL. And you will give the base path. I hope you recollect when we saw a path, we said that we will declare the base path once and we will not reuse it all the time. We will declare it just once. So this is the base path for the API that we are documenting is called as API cart. We just saw how to add an item to the cart through UI and through the postman. So we are doing an API for adding an API to the cart. And you'll also add a tag. Tag is nothing but a way to identify what is this resource all about. So resource is nothing but a collection of endpoints. So you can see that in this particular example, I showed you four endpoints. One is a post, add items to cart. One is a get, retrieve items from cart. So these different endpoints are all acting on the cart. So that is called as endpoint. And these endpoints together are called as resources. So we'll give an intuitive or something, a name that is easy to understand. Cart resource, help your customers make informed. Here we're saying your customers because we are not addressing the customers. Whenever we should also be mindful who we are addressing. Here when you say that help you, we are talking to the storefronts. We are talking to the store admins. Cart resource helps your customer make informed purchase decision and enables you to measure results through tracking and monitoring sales, coupon usage, product popularity, because these are the things that store owners will be concerned with. They would like to know what is the popularity of my product, which product are more in demand, what are available and what are to be stocked. So these are the information we should cover in the tags. Then comes the path. In the path, we will just cover the partial path because base path we have already declared it here. So we will not cover base path once again. We will cover the partial path, which is actually together base path plus this path together becomes a particular endpoint. But in this documentation, this is the best practice to follow. So I'm just showing you how it is done. Then comes the post. This path that when you are adding an item to a cart, this is a post method. So I will mention the method here. And we will also mention what this method performs. So it is basically a quick summary is add items to cart. And every documentation in YAML should mention an intuitive operation ID, which is nothing but items to cart, just to ensure that what kind of operation this post is doing. But only thing about operation ID that you have to keep in mind is that whenever you have an operation ID, which is similar to the schema that we will come up next, similar to an object name, then if it is a duplicate name, it can throw errors when you try to automate the documentation workflow. So only thing you need to make sure this operation ID is unique and it is not conflicting with other names that you have already used in the documentation. Then comes parameters. So you will see, you saw different parameters. There are query parameters, there are path parameters, there are header parameters that we saw earlier. So those parameters we need to document here. So the one I showed you a bit earlier was having a key. So the key name is sitex_context here, and that key has to be provided in the header. So I will mention where it should be input is the header and the description of the key. The description of the key is that this particular key, relevance is for a multi-tenancy or single tenancy. So if it's a multi-tenant platform, multiple people, multiple teams can use the same key. In a single tenant, only one system can use that. And it is very important to specify whether this parameter is mandatory or optional. So that's why required equal to true means mandatory. Required equal to false means optional. And the example we saw, it had a request body. That's why all the request bodies are converted into a schema when it comes to, it's always a JSON object, and JSON objects translates as schema in the YAML file. We'll also talk about schema in a short while. So this is schema. We are just declaring a schema. We are not defining it right now. We are just declaring that there is a schema called cited context. Dot reference means that refer to, in the component section, refers to schema, and the schema name is cited context. But we will be defining it sooner. So this is the path parameter, that header parameter that we just documented. Then we will document the request body. Request body's purpose is to add items to the cart. So that thing is mentioned. And we will mention what kind of data we are going to provide. So it's a JSON file. So this is the format we need to use. I'm copy pasting because I've already prepared it and kept, just to save time. I am taking information from there. At any point, if you have any question, you can please feel free to ask me, or we have a Q&A session towards the end. You can wait for the Q&A session to ask your questions. So we saw that the base, the request was also a JSON format, JSON object. So we will define that here. So you should remember one thing, that when you start working on a YAML file, you will have a little bit of struggle because YAML file is very particular about the indentation. So there could be some indentation issues which could lead to, you saw a structural or parser error. So you can troubleshoot using, some indentations. So some of the errors will go away because we have defined certain attributes, certain schemas, but we have declared it, but we have not defined it. So as and when we define it, many of the structural errors will go away. So this request body is true because the API would not run without the request body. So I have to mention it is true here. And in the responses, you should explain what are the responses that you will get when you run an API. It could be either a success or a failure. If it is a success, it would be 200 okay, or 200 successful. Or if the API failed, you will get a message accordingly. So we are going to define the responses. This response is for a success message, that's why it's 200. You have to also mention that whenever you get a success response, what will you get in return? You will always get a JSON file, a JSON object back. So that's what you're going to mention now. You have got a response 200. What is the type of content you will get? You will get a JSON file. And what is the name of that object? So the name of the object is what we are going to define now. Supposing the API failed because the item that the user tried to add was not in stock, so you will get an appropriate error message. So if the item is not in stock, you will get 404. That means they have to wait or they have to pick an alternative item. since is an error, all this content doesn't apply because you will only get a one liner saying not in stock. So it is not a JSON object that it returns. So this error message will not have any object defined like schema as it is available in the 200 location. So just to give you a brief, in Swagger Editor, if you're starting a clean slate, you will start with what is the type, what is the version you're using, what is the metadata. This is open API version. This is a version of your API, whether it's a first version. Then the title, description, and contact. This is metadata is common across, so you can create just once and reuse in all your files. From here is where actual endpoint starts. And once you declare the base path here, you just have to mention the rest of the path in the path section. You have to mention what is the method used, whether it's a post or a get. And if it's a post or a get, whatever the method is, what does it do? So that is, it adds items to the cart. There is one more item that you can add, which is description. This is important only when you have to give additional information. So this is just a title. So if you want to give a lot more information, it is not appropriate to give it all in all everything in the title. So you can give it in the description. So this is just an additional information. When you say add items to cart, there might be a doubt that if you don't log in, how does it work? If you log in, how does it work? So if you have any additional information, you can add a description and provide. But title, it's always best to keep as very simple. This is just add items to cart. Description is for just additional information. So I'm not including it right now. So similarly, if a user wants to retrieve data from cart, so they will create get request. The same thing we did, it will repeat. So you have to create once. It may look little confusing, or it may look, this indentation might create a little problem in the first one or two days, but you will get a hang of it and how to indent, when to indent, what are the attributes to be used. So this is the way you will create a get request as well. You will mention the path, you will mention a summary and operation ID. And operation ID would be get cart or get items from cart. Simple, the smaller, the shorter, the better. And the parameters that you would require, or if you don't require, you can leave the whole section blank. If your request body is required, then what is the request body? What is the name of the object that you are going to define? So now that we have defined an object, items to cart, we have not, we have declared it, but we have not defined it. So we'll come to that right now. So this comes to the bottom section. After all the endpoints, here you see only one endpoint. If you have multiple endpoints, after all the endpoints are defined, you will talk about the schemas that we have mentioned here. The schemas are nothing but objects that are part of JSON files. In the objects are referred to as schemas in the YAML file. So this whole section where you're going to define the schemas are called as components. Then comes the name schema. You can see that we had declared a Citext content somewhere here. Can you see a dollar reference? So all the dollar reference, the YAML file will check whether you have mentioned dollar reference, whether for each and every dollar reference here, there is items to cart, here cart details. For each and every, do we have a corresponding schema? That's what these errors are saying. So we are going to define the site context. This, as I mentioned, this schema is nothing but an object. That's why its type is object. We will also mention when, but this is only applicable in a request. If in a response, it is not relevant. But in request, you will always mention whether, when you're requesting certain information, whether all the information are required or if are there any mandatory optional optional sections. For example, so this particular site is context has channel, date, account, and stage. There are only four parameters, and all four are important. Then you will mention properties. In properties, you will have the same pattern. This all the channel, date, account will be repeated. Let me start with date. You should always mention what it is. Even though it is intuitive, you can mention, you should add a description, which is here it's a localized date. What is the data type? You should mention the data type in all these are called attributes, channel, date, account, stage, all these elements within the object is called an attribute. And you should give an example to show the user, developers, what was the format that they are using for the date. Sorry. So same way I will do for channel, account, stage, etc. So I'm just copy pasting here. So I mentioned date. Now I will mention channel. Indentation has to be carefully looked into. Otherwise, YAML could give you a lot of errors and you spend a lot of time fixing those indentation issues. But in a matter of a week's time, you will know what goes where. So same way, this is a little bigger JSON file. I'm just copy pasting just to save time. So this is the same approach used to create the whole thing. This is items to cart. We had declared it here in the request body. Dollar reference items to cart. So that has to be mentioned here. What is that you're going to add in the cart? You will add a cart ID, then you will add a user token, you will add a requested user items. So those information will be documented here. So likewise, you can document the an entire API. So just for your reference, I will, so this is how an API is documented. You will give a metadata, you will mention path, tags, servers, and in the path, you will mention what is the method, summary, operation ID, then parameters. So this structure might be a little strange at the first, but trust me, it won't take a long time for you to figure out what comes when and when it has to be modified. So just to save time, I'm going to load the document I have already created, and you will see that we have created the document for the post, which will include the site X contest that we just mentioned. Here, the description will come. Here, what are the parameters? It's an object. That's why it comes with a curly bracket opening and curly bracket closed. Then comes a request body. Since we mentioned required, it will come as required here. And the type we mentioned as JSON. That's why it's coming as application JSON. And this is a request body. From the request body that we have added manually there, you can see this is how it will render. This is a request body, and this is the response. This is a little longer response, but this is the similar to what we have added as an item to cart. Just for reference, I showed you adding an item to the cart in the UI and adding an item to the cart through the API, through the postman. So these are the documentation for the get cart. So in the get cart, there is no request body. That's why you don't see any request body, but you do see a cart ID here, which has to be added as a query parameter in the path itself. Similarly, you will get a response like this. It's a JSON response. If you want to make any changes, you can, if you want to make, okay, you realize that, okay, this deleted has to be true. Then you will have, you just have to click here. You just have to click on this arrow and go back to that place, and you can modify, you can make those changes here. So this is an intuitive way to go to the place where you need to make changes. From here, you can make changes. And these are all the schemas that we have defined. So after all the endpoints, you will start defining the components and schemas. Schemas, as I mentioned, are the objects, JSON objects that is there in the Postman. So site context, the corresponding data is here. So it's hard to read it from this the left-hand pane. That's why it's much easier to read it from the right-hand pane. Since we mentioned all four parameters, all four attributes as mandatory, it is showing as mandatory here. So this is the demo of an API documentation using Swagger Editor. So all the attributes that we have dollar reference, wherever dollar reference is mentioned, the corresponding position will be available here. And by clicking on this arrow, you can go to that respective. So if a particular detail has to be added, for example, you need to add quantity here, you can do so. You can copy paste. You create once and you reuse so that you don't have to create again. So quantity, the quantity, you have to, then you can. This is a number. So you'll change the data type to number. And you will change it to 2. So this is how, and if you see, it would have reflected in the total price here. If you so when you go to total price, you see that quantity, that the one I added in the left hand side will easily reflect into the right side. So that's about it from the documentation perspective. So to say what's next, I would say that whenever this might not look very friendly UI and very easy to use, but when I saw these screens, I was thinking whether I need to have any programming skills or whether I will be able to get it, but it wasn't very tough. I took about 1 week to 10 days to familiarize with this screen, but within a month I could know that why, when an error comes, I was able to understand why an error came and why what changes I need to make in the documentation and stuff like that. So there will be free APIs available, public APIs available that you can use. You can document it in Swagger and then use because the APIs, when you run it in the Postman, it will always be in JSON format. And whereas you are documenting in YAML, but the response is also JSON. So there are online tools to compare JSON schema with JSON schema. So you can compare and see whether you have documented it right. And learn a little bit of open API specification that is also industry standards, followed by many companies, include Google, Facebook, Microsoft. So programming skills are not important, but if you have, you will be able to get a better hand of it. So I guess now we can, if there are any questions, you can ask me.
Please go on.
Hi Sarita, I'm totally from non-engineering background. As I said, we need some programming skills. What would be the skills?
No, I said programming skills are not required. Programming skills are not required. You can learn it. If you have programming skills, it would be helpful, but they are not at all required because I don't have any programming background, or it took me just about 1 week to know that it is not as complicated. Initially, it looked a little bit complicated to me, but it took me some time to get familiar. But someone with programming background might find it a lot easier if they have worked on because they already get used to objects, key value pair, and API key. So these terms might be more familiar for them. Probably they would take maybe 1 or 2 days to get familiarized with documentation, whereas non-programmers like us would take a week or 10 days.
So you're saying like a non-engineering background student also can get with the API documentation. It's not an easy, it's not like any kind of science which is totally abstract.
Absolutely. Because I would say that from my own experience, when I was put into a API documentation, I was a little worried whether I will be able to do it. Looking at these screens, it looked but trust me, it is not at all as difficult as it looks like. It may look even boring, but it is pretty interesting. So totally possible for anybody with curiosity to learn more.
Yeah, thank you for the information.
Thank you.
Sarita, can you explain a little bit more about the Swagger? Is it open source? Is that the editor of choice that you're recommending? And how do we get it? And so I see someone else asked in the chat if it was open source. Is that what you prefer to use?
It's an open source.
Okay, are there others?
You can just search. Okay. You can just search Swagger Editor online. There is an online version called https://editor.swagger.io. You can document there or you can download a version of it. It is free and easy to use.
Okay. And it looked like you were sort of copying and pasting from the JSON. Was that the JSON over from the right where you had Swagger on the left? And on the right.
That's not what I did. Actually, I had created this, the file that you saw here. I was copy pasting from a similar file I had already created before I started the session, because, you know, if I type manually, it might take much more time because I wanted to cover more endpoints. So I copy pasted from another YAML file, which was created in Swagger Editor, into this demo file.
So you were saying, that's how you reuse. Yeah. You kind of create a template and they're all sort of similar. Is that what you mean?
Exactly. So when you first time, you have to create a template of the sort. So the template, as I mentioned, this open API 3.0, the metadata will all be common. You need to create just once, and many of the items you can reuse. So if you have any doubt, you can also see, if you want to know the structure, you can also go to Swagger Editor online version. You will see a pet store. Automatically, they will display a pet store YAML file. The name is pet store. It will cover certain objects about pets and location and stuff like that. Just for people who are new to Swagger Editor to be familiarized with that. So you can have a look at the online Swagger Editor version. If you are comfortable using it, you can download it as well as use it. So that's how it works.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Sarita. This is Anita here. First of all, yes, I would like to say a big thank you, because I have attended other Swagger training sessions, and the way I was able to understand about API documentation was really excellent. And you have a very
thank
good
so
explaining
much.
Things. I had to say that I was waiting for the session to get over so that I could express my appreciation to you. I just want to
know
about the Swagger Hub. Is it anything different than what you showed about the Swagger Editor?
Actually, I have not explored Swagger Hub, but I believe that Swagger Hub is more of a collaboration tool as well. This is not a collaboration tool. Swagger Editor is more independent and suitable for a single use. Swagger Hub is more for a collaboration, but since I have not used it, I cannot comment on exactly the differences, but that's what I heard. It's more of a collaboration tool.
Okay. And I saw that you did write out the YAML on the left-hand side, and we got this JSON format on the right-hand side. So what's the end delivery? Is it a PDF format, or how is it shared with the customers?
Yes, that's a good question. Actually, the YAML is very... it's very versatile. You can build a site, documentation portal using YAML alone. You can build custom API documentation site. You can generate HTML from it. PDF, not so much. PDF, it doesn't support PDF. You can generate, but it is not as straightforward. You need some technical support to generate HTML from the YAML file. And using YAML file, you can also create custom sites. So I'll show you a site right now.
Okay.
Just hold on. So this is a Gitbook. I'm not sure if it's loading right now. So this is a custom site. This is a custom site that was created using YAML. So this has very, very basic information. So you won't see any of the YAML specifications here, but you will just see that what is the path, what is the request, what is the description, that the description we added in the summary, and what are the headers, and what does it consume. So these terms were different from there, but this is all to do with mapping. A front-end developer can create a custom site like this using a YAML file. They can bring it to a different levels of documentation as well. When it comes to documentation, I believe Stripe is a very good example that everybody quotes. So Stripe is like a benchmark for ideal documentation, but it's more to do with more than documentation. It is how a custom site can be built. So you can see the different objects that we created in the YAML file. Those objects will be listed like this. This is a JSON file because it starts with like a curly brackets. This is a JSON response they have created, and the description that we added here. It's called as attributes, that ID. This ID corresponds to the ID here. It is a string. You can see that it is in double quotes. That's why it's mentioned as string. The description is there. What it misses is an example. We also gave importance to examples. So there is an ID. If there is an example here, people would know that ID is a very long alphanumeric number. It is not a four-digit number. So to avoid such complications, a example could have been, and Stripe is a very good example for ideal documentation, because when you say nested objects, they show it very beautifully. You see that address here is a nested object because there is a plus sign here. If you expand it, you will see that other objects within the this particular address. So address is an object. Within that, there is a city, country, address line 1, address line 2, postal code, state. So that's why people always refer Stripe to as an ideal documentation. But more than the file that we use, what you can do with the YAML file, you can create an HTML file, you can create a custom site like this, or you can use other modes of delivery. So,
Hi, this is Pallavi. Can I add to what Sarita has just mentioned? Regarding publishing of the documents, Sarita just mentioned about the Swagger. We already have editor. If you go to editor.swagger.io, you will get on one left hand side, you'll get the YAML file, and right side. But if you go to petstore.swagger, then you'll exactly get what it looks like to the customer. So what Sarita showed, everything was in the editor form, which you will be doing in the while documenting the APIs or testing the APIs, but you can go to how it will look to the customer, the look and feel of it. You can just go to the, I think it's petstore.swagger.com. I'll just ping this in the chat to go and see, to get the look and feel. And just like she said, this publishing basically depends on how your company wants it to be, right? So Swagger helps in publishing. You need to get the website domain, and then that can directly, you can publish it online. But the thing is, Swagger has a particular way of documenting, like the color codes for all the methods. You can't really much customize it. Postman has a different way of customizing. So there are different tools out there for actually publishing it online for the customers. So you can, as she showed, that Stripe has a different way of documenting and not documenting, publishing it online. So you can see that It is all blue, and it has left side has the, so all these things are different and it depends on the tool. or depends on your company, how they want. My company directly publishes, I mean, earlier we used to publish it on WordPress, so we used to get all the details from the developers and just publish it, you know, copy paste it, format in a good the API standard format and publish it. So that's how it goes to the customer. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hi, Sarina. This is Rahul here.
Question.
I just wanted to just give out the questions in the chat box. So I think somebody was asking another question. Like, can you just wait for 5 minutes? Because we'll just read out the questions in the chat box, and I will just get back to you. Is it fine?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Sarita, for the wonderful presentation. Now, I will just read out the questions in the chat box so that you can answer them, okay?
Yes, sure.
Okay. Swati was asking, so where these get and post methods be available to edit, tool to be used? She was saying that I'm a novice to all these concepts, so unable to deduce where to have these methods.
Okay, so one small example, the question is small, but the answer is a little long, so just bear with me. I'll show you a Postman request. So supposing you are new to an organization and you're supposed to be part of an API documentation right away. So you are clueless about what is API documentation. So you can first start with understanding the business. What kind of APIs are they? What is the domain? I mean, whether it's in a fintech or whether it's an e-commerce domain, and who are they serving? Are they serving? Who are the end users? How they are consuming these APIs? What are the APIs? So you try to run those APIs initially. If you are like clear, if you are like have given no particular information, you start running certain APIs in Postman. So I'll give you show you a collection here. These are some of them are very dummy collections. So I'll just show a collection that same example, just to make it easy for you guys. I'm just sharing add items to cart. So you will add items to cart. You will successfully run an API. You will add a request body. You will if there is any parameters like query parameters to be added, if there are any headers to be added, you will add them here. Basically, you will run the API. When you run the API, you will get a response. So from this response, you can start building your documentation from scratch like the way we did. Or the second option is you will contact the developer who has worked on this API. You will ask him or her. You'll ask the developer that whether you have a sample response, that sample request and a sample response. They will, if you are not familiar with Postman and you are unable to run it, you will get a sample request or response from them. If not, most developers add annotations to the code. Annotations are nothing but, you know, for example, we added data types manually. We added that, okay, this particular phone number is of the data type string. This particular quantity is of the data type number. So those information they would have already added as annotation in the code. Once they generate a YAML file for you, you can start working on the YAML file that they have generated. So either you create YAML file from scratch, or before that you request the developer to get you a YAML file. If that doesn't work, you try to run the API through Postman and you will get a request and response. You save that as an example. Here you will see save example. Can you see save example? So say once you have a success response, means you get a response successfully, you save that example and use this to build API from scratch. So that time you have to note whether this is a post method. So you need to mention the method is post. If it's a get, you have to mention the. There are multiple methods, but get, post, put, patch are the common ones. So this is how you can get started if you have very little support. But most of the time you will not be asked to document from scratch. If it's a system that is already a little mature and there are people, you know, businesses using the system, there might be some documentation available and you have to build on top of it. The worst case scenario is what we covered, where you have to document the entire YAML file from scratch. So did I answer your question? Did I answer her question?
I hope so, Sarita. Swati, I think the answer suits you fine. Or do you need any further explanation?
No. That's really fine, Sarita. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, Swati.
Yeah.
I think Alpana was adding to that question. Like she was asking, how do I start with for practice and understanding in this API documentation?
Yeah, that's a good question. I would recommend, you know, there is a site called, I'll type it in the message. There is a very good site where you can get started. I just sent it in the meeting chat. So this is this site is something I have recommended extensively because I was just I could resonate with you guys because when I started with API documentation, I felt that it is, you know, Greek and Latin and it was a little confusing. I found this resource to be very exhaustive. Sometimes you have more information that you need, but at the end of it, you will definitely get what you want. It also gives certain, you know, weather APIs and all to try out. So I can start with something small like weather API, and then you try some publicly available API, public APIs that are free to use. So you will find that when you Google search it, you will get public APIs for training. You can use a Google search and get some APIs and you start. So you can start with, as I mentioned, Postman is not a requirement for technical writers. But when you use an API, when you run an API, that's when you actually get a perspective of what kind of problems a developer would face when they run an API. Supposing a particular field is mandatory and our documentation doesn't say it's mandatory, they will keep running it and they will not get a result because they wouldn't have mentioned it. So how important documentation is stems from the fact that when you run it, you will know what are the challenges. So this is I would rather be writing is a good resource to start with. Then of course there are YouTube videos available that you can see, but this is the site I rely on extensively.
Okay, Sarada, thank you. Pardon me, but due to time constraints, I am skipping a few questions and moving on with another few.
Darshan has sent some httpbin.org. I think these are resources for
Rajesh was asking can you help with any open source API documentation sites? So Darshan was replying to it. Hope this answers Rajesh's question, right, Sarada?
Yes, these are good places to start with.
Okay. And one other thing, Prasad was asking from JSON how to identify which is a header and which is a body and also which is the actual API call. I think Tanishree somebody was replying it in the chat box.
Okay, so you will know from JSON that this is a GET request and this is from right below the GET request, you will have the path. Right below that, you will have parameters, you will have headers, and you will have body. So if you don't know what it is, you will have to run it, and then you will get into error. And then error message will point out that you need certain. So you have to work with developers if you are totally unaware of, you know, how to run it, like you're not familiar with Postman, and you don't know what are the required, what are not required, you need to work with developers or testers. There will be quality assurance team. I have done that as well. I have sat with testers. I have asked them, you know, what should we for this API is not working for me. What should I add it in the headers? What should I add it in the body? Can you share me what is the body or sample request? Multiple attempts, you will be able to run it. Once you run it successfully, it's better to save it as an example. You can click save an example. So that way you can save it and rerun it. So that is a good start. So when you are not sure how, you can ask someone, especially the developers.
Okay, thank you, Sarada. I think we can wind up with the questions from the chat box. I think somebody else was asking a question before I started. Can you ask that now? I hope somebody else was asking Sarada a question before I started reading out the question.
I'm not sure who it was.
Okay.
I think Rahul This was Rajesh, and the question was asked, and I guess Darshan has responded there. The question was about, can you help with any open source API documentation site? I think Darshan has already provided that. So probably okay. If anybody else has question, we can take up probably last two questions and we can wind up.
Yeah, I had one. This is very simple, probably, Sarita, but are the end users of the of our AP documentation, would that be the developers or the solution architects?
Yes, the
developers.
So there are three aspects to it. When a company is offering a service, for example, somebody is offering an e-commerce API for use, initially there will be an evaluation stage. In that evaluation stage, mostly developers may not be involved. That time, probably the decision makers like CTOs, because they have to invest money on buying some APIs from a third party. So they have an evaluation stage. So to evaluate an API, mostly they will rely on the documentation, on what is the capability of that API, what that API can do. So the first, before the API is, you know, API becomes a contract between two services, first it is evaluated. At that stage, the decision makers are CTOs and probably solution architects. So at that point, our stakeholders are them. And later on, only when it becomes a service, when it becomes a service contract, at that point, our interactions are with developers who integrate these APIs into their system. So the documentation is catered to both users, somebody who will evaluate and somebody who will use it and run it and test it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. So we're really helping. I'm just trying to get an idea of, you know, as tech writers, how we can promote, you know, our service. If some people like are saying in the chat, they're not involved in it yet at their company. But you know, the way we can promote it is by saying it's like an added value for the developers. And as you said, the guy, Tom Johnson, mentions it on his site as, I think, one of the weak points. The third item was documentation, right? Earlier in your
yes.
presentation. Yeah. Okay.
Hello everyone. If nobody is having further questions, can we wind up the meet session now? Is there anybody with any other questions? I hope everyone is
fine. Yeah, I have one suggestion. Rahul.
Yeah.
If you guys found the session helpful, please message in the WhatsApp group. We have a WhatsApp group or in LinkedIn, because it will
sure.
encourage more participants in the next sessions.
Sure. Yeah, I was getting to that. Like, we'll be having a feedback form after the session meeting. Mails will be sent to the registered participants. You can fill out the form and get back to us on about the session. And as Sarita mentioned, now we are having WhatsApp groups, so feel free to text in the group, like whatever questions pending in your mind or what you genuinely felt about the session. You can ping that in the group also.